On this Animal Blessing Sunday, it is only fitting that we should have a time for all ages, and it's only fitting that our story should be about St. Francis of Assisi, the coolest of all the saints, because he could literally talk to the animals. This is 1,000 years ago, so no cars, trains, or planes, not even a bike. St. Francis had to walk everywhere. He walked all over Europe, North Africa, and the Middle East, and everywhere he went, the animals were there to show him some love. But you know me, if you know Reverend Norm, you know I'm not just gonna tell this story, we're gonna be acting it out. You're gonna be acting it out. So whether you're on site or online, you might wanna get up on your feet if you're comfortable, or sit in your chair, but in such a way that you can move around a little bit. We're gonna stay in one place, but we're also going to be making some moves. Yeah, if parents and kids could at least kind of gather where you're in sound of my voice, that would be great. So like I said, Francis walked a lot. So let's just see that. Let's see walking. Let's see some walking. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, excellent. Thank you, Sally. He's walking, he's walking, he's walking. He's walking up really steep hills. Up the steep hill. He's walking down really steep hills. Oh my gosh. Oh, He has quieter moments. He walks through fields of wheat and puts his hands out to feel the tips of the wheat as he passes through the fields. Let's see that. Finally, one day, Francis comes to a rushing river after all this walking, and he realizes he can only get across the river by stepping from one stone to the next. So let's see that. He's stepping from one stone to the next across the river. Great, Liz, thank you. When he gets to the opposite shore, he meets a fisherwoman who just caught a fish, a nice big trout. It's still alive. The woman sees that Francis must be a holy man and that he's probably hungry. So she offers him the fish, and Francis says, sure, thanks. Now, how do you think that fish would be acting out of the water like that? Let's see that. Not good, right? So Francis feels super sorry for the poor fish, and he says, brother fish, this is no place for you. You should be in the water. And he puts that fish right back in the river. But the fish doesn't swim away. The fish starts playing and flipping his tail. So water sprays up on St. Francis and soaks him head to foot. Let's see the water. Let's see St. Francis covered with water. We got some fish flipping, and Francis just laughs. He kneels down by the water and he says, brother fish, I bless you for your playfulness and your joy, for you have reminded me of the healing power of laughter. Seek out deep waters and do all the fishy things you were meant to do. And so St. Francis goes on his way. He's walking up really steep hills. He's walking down really steep hills. He's walking through fields of wheat and feeling the tips of the wheat under his hands. Finally, he gets really tired, so he finds a quiet spot in the woods, eats a little bread, and lies down to rest. Can you see him lying down to rest? Thank you, Ruth. Beautiful, you're way ahead of me. But there's a noise, a kind of singing or chirping that also sounds kind of like scratching. We're kind of hearing it right now in real time. He opens his eyes, and right there in front of him is a cricket. So St. Francis reaches out his hand. Let's see, just reach out your hand like you're welcoming a little tiny animal onto it. And he says, Sister Cricket, come here. And the cricket leaps onto the palm of his hand. And Francis says, Sister Cricket, will you sing for me? And of course, the cricket sings a joyful cricket song. And St. Francis says, Sister Cricket, I bless you for the simplicity of your song. You have reminded me that what is most beautiful often comes from the creature who is the smallest and most humble. Go seek tall grass and sunny meadows and do what crickets do. And the cricket leapt away, happy to obey. Now we come to the most famous story about St. Francis. He's walking again. He's walking up those hills, working a sweat. He's walking down the really steep hills. Whoa! He's walking through fields of wheat and feeling the tips under his hands. And he comes upon a great crowd of birds of all different kinds. Let's see birds of all different kinds. Let's see, tall birds and short birds. Birds with big wide wings and birds with little short wings. Birds that can fly and birds that can swim. Francis was so entranced that he walked right into the middle of that crowd of birds, but they didn't even budge because they saw he was full of wonder and love. Can we see a person full of wonder and love? Yes, Marilyn, Salome, thank you, Katie. Beautiful. Now, St. Francis was a very famous preacher. It was a gift he had, and he liked to share it to help people understand the world better, to help them see the joy in the world around them. So he said to that great crowd of birds, "I'd like to preach to you, if I may." Suddenly, all the birds were quiet, not a peep. And Francis preached to them, not like some superior human being talking down to the dumb animals, no. He thanked them for everything they taught him. He thanked them for inspiring him with the way they flew through the air and swam through the water, or both. He thanked them for the sense of joy and freedom. He thanked them for the faith that all would be well with the world. He said to the birds that day, "You are my siblings. Together we are creatures of this earth. Together we praise our creator, the creator of all things, who has given us different ways to move across this great green earth of ours. Me on my clumsy legs and you with the gifts of feather and freedom and flight." At these words, the birds started acting really strange. They stretched their necks as long as they could. Let's see that. They stretched their necks. They spread their wings as far as they could reach. Some took to the air and flew great circles around him. Let's see that. And Francis said to them, "I bless you for the joy you bring to those of us who are bound to the earth. I bless you for the beauty you bring to those of us who are too sad or too scared to sing. I bless you for lifting our hearts closer to the heavens. Go forth now and do what birds do. Fill the air and the water with your joy." And he lifted his arms high. Let's see that. And the birds filled the sky and flew away. St. Francis is now alone, quiet and peaceful, full of love for the earth and all its inhabitants. He wondered what new blessings, what new creatures he might find as he continued his journey. And so he began to walk, walking up steep hills, walking down steep hills and across fields of wheat, where he ran his hands over the tips of the stalks and knew God's bounty. And he said, "Amen." Have a seat. Thank you so much. So just as St. Francis blessed the fish and the bugs and the birds, we will bless our animals now, those who are here today and those we carry in our hearts and those who are online. With safety and distancing in mind, we're going to make this a collective and communal blessing rather than having people come up one at a time. If you're online and have an animal to bless, please hold them up or aim them at the camera so we can see them. Bring those furred, winged, fin, scaled, or plush animals to your screens. If you're here on site, make sure I can see you. And I can see most of you now. You're good over there. I think this is the most animals we've had, certainly in the time that I've been doing this. So it's a huge gift. And if you're here and don't have your animal with you, but have one at home, hold up a picture, including just like put a picture on your phone and hold it up so that we can see it. Yes, the Loudermilks have a picture of their cat back there. Beautiful. So with all this love in our midst, with these animal companions here with us today, let us enter together into this moment of blessing. Spirit of life and of love, spirit that moves through and among and within all creation. Bless these, our beloved pets. Bless these, the honored members of our families. Bless them for the playfulness that reminds us of the healing power of laughter. Bless them for the simplicity of their songs and the reminder that what is most beautiful often comes from the most humble of creatures. Bless them for lifting our hearts closer to the heavens. spirit of life and of love, spirit that moves through and among and within us. Bless our beloved animals with good health and long life. Bless them with all that they love best. Romps in the woods, naps in the sun, balls to chase, catnip to relish, aquariums and terrariums to explore, songs to sing, and human hearts to fill. May they interrupt our work as they walk across our keyboards, lure us outside for a walk, or demand another scratch of the belly. May they know our love through our actions and our care, just as we know their love through their uncanny knowledge of those times when we need their companionship the most. In offering this blessing to them, may we never forget our responsibilities. May we never forget all that we owe our beloved companions. These creatures who are so often wiser than we can ever hope to be. Amen and blessed be. Feels like a round of applause for our animals, for our companions, for those we love and for those who love us. Our Davies kids now, if you want to head off with Katie and Salome for some activities, whatever you have in mind, or you can hang out, totally up to you. We're going to move on to the second half of our service with a reading, with a reading from CJ.
Thank you, Reverend Noah. Our reading this morning comes from Reverend Teresa Soto. It's called When Your Best Friend Has Four or So Legs, and it's included in their book, Spilling the Light. What it means to have a pet is to love someone who speaks a language you do not. A dog will bow and prance. A cat will purr and blink. A guinea pig will giggle and squeak. A long time ago, a friend of mine had a dog with soft ears and considered herself the pup's guardian, a gentle way to think of protecting and caring for a friend, such a small gesture of respect for a source of boundless love. The dog's long pink tongue lolling in a goofy grin, the cat convinced that kneading and grooming are crucial to this day. A bird asking for a treat, bending a wing to wave. These are friends, and they are loves. It's kind of a surprise that you should love someone so much who would eat the butter on the table if they could get away with it. And it gets endless hair on the sofa when they aren't even supposed to be on the sofa. When they are called companion animals, it's such an open, tender truth. The endless cuddles and tricks and loyalty, the comfort of fingers to fur and big adoring eyes. These are friends, they are loves. They stretch our hearts and fill them with their abundance of kindness. When they are gone, our hearts remain larger. Through their absence leaves room for expanses of grief. Their love champions and companions us still.
Thank you, CJ. I'm going to offer just a brief homily this morning because I cannot wait to get over here and meet a puppy and some dogs and cats that are kind of roaming around. So I'm going to keep this brief. But I am going to open my brief homily with a sorrow. It seems trivial, perhaps, and I know it's not a permanent sorrow, but the hummingbirds are gone. Since spring, I've made absolutely sure that our two hummingbird feeders, one on either side of the house, are always full. I didn't want our hummingbird guests, for even a moment to think we dropped the ball, and I didn't want them to leave and go to someone else's house where there was a full hummingbird feeder. So as some of you know, my morning practice every day is to rise before dawn, make the coffee, then settle into a big old armchair where I read and study for an hour or so with my dogs to either side of me. That spot, that armchair, just happens to look out on one of these hummingbird feeders. It's always a thrill to see that first little guy show up in the morning. Then throughout the day, I'll glance out our big picture window and see them zooming about in the sun, darting up and down, pausing in midair, and then zipping away, only to zoom back into view a moment later. My sacred practice of an afternoon nap is usually taken next to an open window, which is blessed by a soft breeze. And that nap is often underscored by the whir of their wings and that funny chortling call that they make. Hummingbirds give me such enormous and simple delight. In thinking about them and in mourning their recent departure south, I realized I've been mistaken in how I understand the words blessing of the animals. I've been thinking of it as a ritual that we celebrate each year when we bless them. That is, practically speaking, what we do. It's what we just did. We blessed the animals. But this year, I'm acutely aware that we're also talking about the blessing of the animals on us. This is something my man, St. Francis, understood. A humble saint, he didn't go around deigning to bless the poor, dumb creatures of the world. He lived alongside them, gloried in their company, expressed his gratitude, repeatedly saved them from becoming someone else's dinner. Our Time for All Ages was a sort of medley of stories compiled by Francis's first biographer, Thomas of Solano, who knew Francis well. They traveled together, walking up and down those steep paths. They lived together in the same small community, worked the fields side by side to earn their bread. Thomas is a firsthand witness. Thanks to him, we even know what Francis looked like. Here's what Thomas tells us. He had a kind face and a beard that was black and sparse. He was of medium height, closer to short. His head was of medium size and round. His face was long and drawn, his forehead small and smooth, with medium eyes, black and clear. And I love this sentence. His clothing was rough, his sleep was short, his hand was generous. His clothing was rough, his sleep was short, his hand was generous. Thomas also gives us firsthand accounts of Francis as a preacher. As he writes, as he brought forth the word from his mouth, he moved his feet as if dancing, not playfully, but burning with the fire of divine love, not provoking laughter, but moving us to tears of sorrow. Tears of sorrow, yes, but we also hear of Francis's deep joy. Thomas of Solano writes, the breath of the divine whisper with his ear perceived in secret would burst forth in a song of joy. At times, as we saw with our own eyes, he would pick up a stick from the ground and putting it over his left arm would draw it across as if it were a violin. Francis's preaching was so fully embodied that his words would transform into dance. He was so joyful in the knowledge of life's miracles that he would burst into song and take up a stick like a little kid and pretend it was a violin. It makes me think of my dogs when they play pretend, when they pounce and wrestle and exhibit their astounding powers of imagination. It makes me think of cats who play endlessly with a length of yarn. It makes me think of being on the coast of Alaska, the coast of California, the coast of New England, and watching whales at play. But I don't want to paint a false or misleading picture of St. Francis. He was complicated. He had bad days. He had deeply sorrowful days. He knew failure and betrayal. He only lived to be 44. In his final years, he was nearly blind and a victim to some of the most horrific medical procedures of the 13th century. But even with death just hours away, he calls for two brothers to sing for him. He even attempts to sing one of the Psalms himself. In describing the actual moment of his death, Thomas of Solano writes that Francis, quote, was absorbed into the abyss of light. He was absorbed into the abyss of light. My hummingbird feeders have remained full and untouched for a week now, and I will take them down this afternoon. And that's going to be okay, because in these last couple of days, there's been a new sound in the air, an anticipation of new life, a great choral honking of geese now punctuates my quiet mornings in that old armchair. If they're true to last year's routine, the flock will soon settle around the pond just beyond our woods, and I'll have the opportunity to visit them every day as the dogs and I take our morning walk. The months will pass and the hummingbirds will return, and the blessing of the animals upon us will continue without cease. May it be so. Amen.